first and hopefully not our very last 10 Below Variety Show. I'm your host of the evening, the host of the most, John Cromer, for those of you who don't know me, welcome to meeting. Okay, so, folks, we are here tonight for a wonderful, wonderful cause, and I am very pleased and very proud to be a part of this. And I want to send a special thank you to our executive producer for the evening, the lovely, talented Caroline Engvall for her buddy behind the scenes, nothing behind every good woman is a good man who's pandering to her. Carl Engvall is back there too from the Carolina. So there's a lot of people to put this show together, and we're going to see some incredible acts tonight, some very, very cool local talent. And it would not have been possible without our audition judges. So three lovely ladies who braved the cold Vermont winter to come out and we always spoke so nervous because we had to, it's like, oh no, we're gonna get rejected for the show. No, you're not either. Show up, you're breathing in and out, you're in, okay? I mean, they got me up here, so come on, you know. So I want to submit special, first of all, to a lady who's former educator and longtime friend of the arts, the lovely and talented Miss Jo Mathur. And then we'll have a trained musician, who you will see a little bit later in the show as the judge becomes a performer. Miss Emily Taylor. And last but certainly not least, the lady who runs our library and media center here in Bristol. If you have not ever visited Lawrence Library, how come? Seriously. All right, Nancy Wilson. Nancy, you have your daughter. At this time, you know, I really want to, you know, say I'm a library head from way, way back. It is great, and especially in this day and age, when everybody has one of these. So instead of the interwebs doing this, we're actually gonna talk to each other. You can go down there and actually have conversations with folks. It's a beautiful thing. Oh, by the way, I want everybody to do what I just did. That boy out. Come on, everybody, everyone. And I want you to take the little switch on the side and turn it to off. There we go. Okay, flash photography. Yeah, okay. No flashing in the audience, please. Again, take pictures, do video. We're gonna have some fun tonight. Buzz Coons is also here to, and you'll be taking, snapping pictures as well. So, all right, folks, it's time. Without any further ado. Oh, I need that. Ladies and gentlemen, our first act tonight is wonderful. I heard them warming up backstage. Lots of fun. Mr. Jack Mayer on a soprano recorder. Chip Mayer on the alto recorder and the nose flute. Ms. Ann Wallace on tenor recorder and the nose flute. Mr. David Gusikoff, viola, violin, and the kazoo. Ladies and gentlemen, evidently my best Maurice Chevalier, Les Buzzers.
I lost him. Performance of Les Bozos, a complex blend of two musical families, the Mayers and the Wallace Goosikoffs. We perform early music from 2 to 4 a.m., serial commercials, vocally complex rounds, rhomboids, and hyperbole, and nasal music. After a 25-year career, Les Bozos' first CD is still coming out. And our first world tour is still canceled. Bookings are available from your local police department and through our secret agent.
We have to
okay.
Let's
have
to have a
discussion.
Okay.
You
want to get in there? No?
It's
comfortable. Fair Phyllis, I saw sitting all alone,
feeding her flock near to the mountainside.
Fair Phyllis, I saw sitting all alone,
feeding her flock near to the mountainside.
The shepherd knew not whither she was gone.
When he found her. Then they fell a kissing, when he found her.
Song Green Sleeves was allegedly composed 500 years ago by King Henry VIII for his lover and future queen consort Anne Boleyn. According to this theory, Anne Boleyn rejected King Henry's attempts to seduce her, and this rejection is referred to in the song when the writer's love cast me off discourteously. Tonight, in this very hall, for the very first time in this century, Chip Mayer and Anne Wallace will perform Greensleeves on nose flute without a decongestant.
And without a net.
They require complete concentration. We ask for your utter silence during this high-risk performance. Those in the front three rows might want to take precautions.
Do you want to be over here? A thing?
Okay. Okay.
Singers, songwriters, man, woman, no children, I don't know. It's not my business, stuff up there. Ladies and gentlemen, Mara Urban and Mark Gibson doing a little song. Voice and acoustic guitar for us.
Laughing at.
Okay. we could just take this off
Oh, my life.
thank you once again for Mara and Mark. Thank you for that lovely radio show. No, it's not really. It's bittersweet. But anyone who's been in and around this hall for nearly the last two decades knew a very special young lady who also happens to be my fiance. Yeah, I like it, so I put her big on it. Hi, honey.
Hi.
Darla came to me earlier today. She goes, you know, if you need somebody to fill in for a little bit, and we've got some folks warming up backstage that are going to take a couple of minutes. So wanted to kind of give Darla her farewell swan song. She has material especially prepared for tonight, didn't you, honey?
Yes.
Yeah. Darla, come on up here, honey.
Walked up to the desk and said, "Book, book, book!" And Nancy gave her books, books, books. And out the door went the chicken, down the road, to the pond, over the hill, never to be seen again. Or the next day, the little red hen returned her books, as all good library patrons should, and she said, "Book, book, book!" And so once again, Miss Nancy gave her some books, and out the door drags the books with the chicken, and off the road, down the hill, by the pond, never to be seen again. Or the third day, back comes in the chicken with the books, and she says, say it with me, folks, book, book, book! So Nancy's like, okay, chicken, I'm coming with you this time. So cross the road, down the hill, to the pond, the chicken drops the books, and there's the biggest frog Nancy has ever seen in her life. And the frog hops over to the books and he says, read it.
They were actually doing the soliloquy from Hamlet, and which is really cool because they're only about this tall. But actually, are we ready back there?
Yeah.
Oh, there's a thumb. There's a thumb and it's attached to a person. Ladies and gentlemen, a treat with our young thespian group under the direction of Melissa Jennison. I present to you the enormous carrot.
Say our lines. Are we ready, Don Treaders?
Yeah!
All right. So, our story begins. Early one spring, Daisy the rabbit planted seeds in her garden. Plant, plant, plant. Each day she watered and weeded. Everything grew exactly as she had planned. Then one day, Daisy discovered an enormous carrot growing in the middle of her garden, and she was so surprised. And she said, "This carrot is ready to pick."
This carrot's ready to pick.
So she tried to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground, but the carrot stayed put. It wouldn't come out. So frustrating. Well, along came her friend, Mabel the cow, mooing as she came. Skipping and mooing. And Daisy said to her friend, "Will you help me pull this carrot out?
Will you help me pull this carrot out?
And Mabel said, "Naturally." She memorized her line. So they tried together to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground. They heaved and they hoed. But the carrot stayed put. It wouldn't come out. Just then, their friend, Nolan the chicken, came clucking along. And Mabel said, "Will you help us pull this carrot out?" And Nolan said, "Absolutely."
Absolutely.
So they all tried together to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground. They teamed and they towed, but that carrot stayed put. It wouldn't come out. Just then, their friend Bella the dog came woofing along.
You said Bella the dog.
And Nolan asked, "Will you help us pull this carrot out?
Will you help us pull this carrot out?"
"Sure thing,"
said Bella the dog. So they all tried together to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground. They stretched and they swayed and they pulled really, really hard and showed the audience, yes. But the carrot stayed put. It wouldn't come out. Just then, their friend Claire the cat came meowing along. And Bella asked, "Will you help us pull this carrot out of the ground?"
"Will you help us pull this carrot out of the ground?"
"That thing!"
And she also said, "I'd be delighted."
"I'd be delighted."
So they all tried together to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground. They hollered and they hauled. But the carrot stayed put. It was really frustrating. It wouldn't come out. Just then, their tiny friend, Anya the mouse, came squeaking along. She's as quiet as a mouse. And she said, in her biggest mouse voice, "May I help you pull that carrot out?"
"May I help you pull that carrot out?"
"You're much too small,"
said Claire. "We know that's not very nice, so..." Then Anya said, with her big muscles showing, "Let me try."
"Let me try."
So they all tried together to pull the enormous carrot out of the ground. They tugged and they lugged. They heaved and they hoed. And they're still pulling really hard, right? Everybody's pulling really hard. Because you need to make that carrot come out. When I say they hollered and they hauled, and all at once the enormous carrot puffed out. And they ate every last bit of that enormous carrot until it was all gone. Hi, carrot. And their bellies were so full from all that carrot, they rubbed their bellies. Yep. And then that afternoon, Daisy said, "I can't wait to see what comes up tomorrow."
"I can't wait to see what comes up tomorrow."
And then Bella said, "Neither can I."
"Neither can I."
"But first it's time for an enormous rest."
"First it's time for an enormous rest."
The end.
Thank you.
gentlemen, the newest Shakespearean troupe. It's been my great pleasure to live here in Bristol for the last 6 years now, and I have had the opportunity to be on the stage several times, to meet, to play with, to perform with some incredible performers. Ladies and gentlemen, we have just met the next generation. Speaking of great performers here in town, this next gentleman is going to come up and share some stories with us. I first had the opportunity to hear him as a storyteller. We all know him as a photographer. And if any of you have seen some of Buzz's work over the years, you look at it and go, if he can tell a story half as good as he can take a picture, we're in for a treat, and that we are. I had the great pleasure of working with him last fall at our very first poetry slam. And he came with his wife and his son, Sam. And just the spontaneity and the fun that they brought to the room that night was something to see. So he's going to come, Buzz is going to come out here, and he's going to do a little, he wanted me to let you know he's going to talk a little bit about ice fishing. So ladies and gentlemen, our Vermont storyteller extraordinaire, Mr. Buzz Coons.
It's a curious vice to drill through the ice when it's all that's supporting your weight and preventing a grim and untimely swim that would seal your unfortunate fate. And it might seem strange to rearrange your life around a singular goal, especially an aim so apparently lame as pulling fish from a hole. But for certain folk, it's not a joke, and once they get ice fishing fever, it's a thing they can't kick. It's like chasing a stick for a Labrador retriever. I'm sad to say it went that way for a friend of mine from Goshen. Recounting this tale, I never fail to get choked up with emotion. Because my old buddy Chad was a cheerful lad, a perpetual smile on his face, a harmless oaf who liked to loaf around his hilltop place. But his carefree fun came all undone to be replaced with sorrow. When just on a whim, I said to him, "Wanna go ice fishing tomorrow?" Champlain's expanse would provide a chance to pursue our winter sport, and 20 below with a chance of snow was the perfect weather report. When we got there, I said, "We'll load up this sled with tip-offs and some bait, and then we'll hike to this place I like where the fishing's always great." So off we trudged for what Chad judged was 100 miles or so. The north wind howled and Chad we scowled, half blind by the driving snow. When we finally stopped, to the ice he flopped, exhausted from the journey. He said, "I wish we'd brought some kind of a cot or maybe a hospital gurney." But I just laughed and said, "Don't be daft, we haven't a minute to waste. There's no time to kill, we got holes to drill and there's tip-ups to be placed." So Chad grabbed the auger and worked like a logger, drilling with reckless abandon. And so pretty quick, the tip-ups were thick around the place where we were standing. With the hooks all baited, we anticipated the fish would soon be biting. And Chad had to admit that until they bit, the suspense was kind of exciting. But the hours passed and the thrill didn't last. And as the evening fell, still no fish came to visit. And Chad said, "How is it that the doggone fish can tell?" He said, "I wonder what goes on down under this layer of frozen lake. I'd like to see where those fish might be, so a peek through this hole I'll take." So down he bent, and his eyeball went right to the water's brim, and to his surprise, he saw two huge eyes staring right back at him. That icy stare gave him quite a scare, but he couldn't avert his gaze. And what happened next, it greatly vexed Chad for all his remaining days. Quick as a wink, from down in the drink, out of spite I can only suppose, that beast of the deep made a sudden leap and bit off the end of Chad's nose. Chad quickly recoiled, but his face was spoiled. It would never look the same. And that fish's attack made the poor man crack. This thing was no longer a game. Such a personal slight changed the rules of the fight, and so an oath Chad swore that lousy fish would one day wish it had never started this war. Well, just then each flag began to wag on the tip-ups placed all around. But when we looked, no fish were hooked. Broken lines were all we found. Chad clenched his jaw when the wreckage he saw, and the truth began to dawn. That fish was playing, and as much as saying, "Okay, buddy, game on." Chad went home in a hurry, in a blinding fury, and replaced each tip-up line with the very best 500-pound test reinforced carbon fiber twine. I tried to assuage his seething rage as his blood pressure surged ever higher, but the throbbing stump of his nasal bump served to fuel his burning ire. With his temper still hot, we returned to the spot where we'd fished the day before. With a sinister leer, he set out the gear and said, "Now we even the score." But we soon found out that the lines being stout wasn't all that mattered, because the lines held fast, but a few seconds passed, and then the tip-ups shattered. Well, he tried using oak. Still the tip-ups broke, so he went to solid steel. But the metal bent when the line was spent, and then it just broke the reel. Chad tried for weeks with different techniques and still more elaborate scheming, but nothing he planned was sufficient to land that evil aquatic demon. Now, to be so obsessed with an ice-bound pest might seem to you dim-witted, but avenging his schnoz had become the cause to which Chad's life was committed. Every day on the lake, he would feel an ache where once his nose had dwelled, and it was as though that dastardly foe was the only thing he smelled. Now, to witness a fellow who had once been so mellow, now going clean off of his rocker, was cause for concern. If things took a wrong turn, he could end up in Davy Jones' locker. And you might think that Chad was just stark raving mad, and I guess I can't say I would differ, but I wager you'd find that you too lose your mind if a fish had stolen your sniffer. Well, finally one day he called me to say he was gonna change his luck. He'd divorced his spouse and sold their house and was to get money to buy a truck. The fish was too big and he needed a rig that would tip the scales in his favor. I could hear in his voice he'd begun to rejoice in the victory he would soon savor. I don't think he planned to spend 86 grand, but the truck that he got was a beaut. It was 4x4 with a crew cab door and a towing package to boot. Each glistening wheel was of high carbon steel with super grip ice blaster tires, whose treads were bejeweled with studs that were tooled in the forges of Satan's own fires. Now, a big block V8 would pull enough weight for most any normal man's need. But Chadley knew this would never do if his mission was to succeed. It would not be enough to have some bit of fluff like you'd find in a Chevy Suburban. So he mounted instead in the pickup truck bed a slightly used F-16 turbine. He said, "See here, I'm no engineer, but I just have to trust that no fish I catch can hope to match 40,000 pounds of thrust." Now, he knew, of course, that to take such force, no nylon rope would be able. So he purchased a length of industrial strength titanium aircraft cable. Away he drove to the big broad cove where his nemesis lay lurking. He parked his new wheels and clicked his heels and then got busy working. He struck a light to some dynamite and gave the sticks a toss, and a few seconds later it blasted a crater 100 yards across. Then he had to be sure that he had a good lure that would tempt the nostril thief, so that to the cable he tied an entire side of organic grass-fed beef. Well, the tactic worked, because the cable jerked the instant the carcass sank. Chad flashed me a look and set the hook by giving the cable a yank. When the hook dug in, he gave me a grin, and I thought, now comes the test, because the scaly beast was headed east and the truck was headed west. With the pedal floored, the turbine roared and the aircraft cable strained, but after an hour at maximum power, not an inch had Chadley gained. As the jet fuel burned and the water churned, I saw disaster brewing. With growing terror, I grasped the error that would soon be Chad's undoing. In his reliance on the turbine appliance, his thinking was incomplete. He'd forgotten the rule that burning jet fuel must generate some heat. As the atmosphere warmed, a puddle formed, foreshadowing Chadley's troubles. A minute elapsed, and the ice collapsed, and the truck left behind only bubbles. As the truck submerged, I fervently urged Chad to give up his foolish ambition. But undeterred, he said, "Don't be absurd, it's just time for some hand-to-hand fishing." With a big gulp of air, he pulled on a pair of flippers he brought just in case, and a snorkeling mask that he brought for the task he pulled on over his face. Tragedy loomed. I knew he was doomed. His chances could not have been slimmer, because that water was cold, and truth to be told, Chad was a total non-swimmer. I begged and I pleaded, but my cries went unheeded. I might just as well have been mute, for on this occasion, no power of persuasion could alter a grudge so acute. Oh, I was so close. No logic could pierce a hatred so fierce. I knew he would never back out. He was bound and determined that freshwater vermin pay the price for stealing his snout. With a heavy heart, I watched him depart for the murky depths below. What would be the result of this watery tumult, it wasn't too hard to know. Under these circumstances, I knew Chadley's chances were microscopically small, and I greatly feared when he disappeared that he wouldn't come back up at all. I piteously wept as my vigil I kept for hours that seemed like years. But that long without breath could mean only death, confirming my very worst fears. But just as the crews from the network news packed up thinking Chad was dead, we heard a sound and turned around and he reared his ugly head. With a swelling pride that he couldn't hide, he shouted with glee, "I got him!" I grabbed his fin in a wrestling pin and held him to the bottom. But a question nagged. If the fish had been bagged, why was Chad now empty-handed? I asked how he could claim victory, since the fish had not been landed. He said, "The monster chose to give back my nose, well, the undigested piece. So it only seemed right, after such a good fight, that I should catch and release. And you may think it's funny that I spent so much money and ended up slightly damp, but it was worth the cost of all that I lost, because now I'm friends with Champ."
Side of the art of Tai Chi called Xuan. I pronounced that correctly, ladies. The martial art aspect of Tai Chi. Yang style fast set, followed by a two-person broadsword exhibition. Sue and Madeline will offer this demonstration with gratitude to their teachers in the Dong family lineage. Ladies and gentlemen, Sue Driscoll and Madeline Piat Langle doing broadsword demonstration.
Xingli.
Madeline. Another hand for our guide today. If you're working with the chords, you only miss once in rehearsal. That's it, just one. So, Darla, did you have a knock-knock joke? You have a knock-knock joke. We're going to bring Darla back up here for her world-famous knock-knock joke.
So, audience participation time. Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Shh. I'm trying to watch the show.
And for that, I put on pants. Yeah, I didn't say they were good. Oh, ladies and gentlemen. I guess there's a few folks that are almost as old as I am. So you remember the 60s and the 70s. Well, maybe you don't remember it, perhaps, but you lived through it. I've always been a fan of British comedy. Very dry, very subtle. You really have to pay attention to it. And you really have to pay attention to British television because there's only five channels. So you really have to like this one. There was BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three, and four's off the air now, BBC Five. So we're going to go back to the days of the BBC. Some of our favorite performers, and they're getting ready backstage. Are you getting ready backstage, gentlemen? No, we're not. Oh, we got a thumb. We have a thumb, ladies and gentlemen. We have a thumb. Bringing back some of the best of Monty Python's Flying Circus. Ladies and gentlemen, for your amusement and amusement, now for something completely different. Mr. Derek Doucette, Mr. Ben Liberelli, Mr. Carl Engvall, Mr. Mark Cicciola, and Mr. Evan Jennison, the four Yorkshiremen.
A Chateau de Chasselier wine ages are.
You've got that right, Obadiah.
Who'd have thought that 30 years ago we'd be sitting here drinking Chateau de Chasselier wine, huh?
Aye, back in them days, we'd been glad to have the price of a cup of tea. A cup of cold tea.
Without milk or sugar.
Or tea.
In a filthy, cracked cup.
We didn't used to use a cup. We used to drink out of a rolled-up newspaper.
The best we could manage was to soak on a damp piece of cloth.
But we were happy in those days, although we were poor.
Because we were poor. My old dad used to say to me, son, money doesn't buy you happiness.
He was right. I was happier then and I had nothing. We used to live in this tiny old tumble-down house with great big holes in the roof.
House? You were lucky to have a house. We used to live in a single room, all 26 of us, no furniture, half the floor missing, and us huddled together in the corner for fear of falling.
You were lucky to have a room. We used to have to live in a corridor.
We used to dream of living in a corridor. Would have been a palace to us. We lived in an old water tank on a rubbish heap. Every morning we were woken up having a load of rotting fish dumped on our heads. House? Huh.
Well, when I said house, it was only a hole in the ground covered by a piece of tarpaulin. But it was a house to us.
We were evicted from our hole in the ground. We had to go and live in a lake.
You were lucky to have a lake. There were 160 of us living in a shoebox in the middle of the road.
Cardboard box?
Aye.
You were lucky. We lived for 3 months in a brown paper bag in a septic tank. We used to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, clean the bag, eat a crust of stale bread, work down mill 14 hours a day, week in, week out, And when we got home, our dad would thrash us to sleep with his belt. Luxury. We used to get up out of the lake at 3 o'clock in the morning, clean the lake, eat handful of gravel, go to work every day for 2 pence a month. And when we got home, our dad would beat us around the head and neck with a broken bottle, if we were lucky.
Well, we had it tough. We used to have to get up out of the shoebox at midnight, eat a half a handful of freezing cold gravel, work 24 hours down at the mill for 4 pence every 6 months, and when we got home, our dad would slice us in two with a bread knife.
Right. I used to get up in the morning at 10 o'clock at night, a half hour before I went to bed, eat a lump of dry poison, work 29 hours a day down at mill, pay me and Lona for permission to come to work, and when we got home, our mother and father would kill us and dance on our graves singing hallelujah.
You try to tell that to the young people today, they won't believe you.
No.
Dinner is served.
Short intermission. Folks, head on back and belly up to the bar. All the proceeds, of course, from tonight are, of course, going to our lovely library. So we'll have a short intermission. That's the one. Chat. Talk amongst yourselves. The A2 number 7 for clarinet, and also the clarinet solo excerpt from Blue Shades. The lovely and talented judge turned performer, Miss Emily Taylor. time back into the 60s again and into the early 1970s. A screenwriter by the name of Jane Wagner was doing some work and came across a young comedian named Lily Tomlin. And at the time, Lily was just starting her comedic career. And those of you now, she's reached several generations. Anybody watches the show Frankie and Grace, we'll see Lily, along with the great Jane Fonda. Lily started out at doing stand-up and doing sit-down comedy, if you will. And she landed a job on a show called Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In in the early 1970s. And for those of you youngsters in the audience, Laugh-In was the Saturday Night Live, the SNL, the Second City, the Wayans Brothers of the early 70s. So taking a little piece of that, one of Lily's most famous characters is a little five and a half year old girl named Edith Ann. And Edith Ann is going to visit us tonight. And it always brings tears to my eyes because my mom does a great Edith Ann as well. But since she's not here tonight, good friend and good neighbor of ours, Miss Robin Hewitt, is going to do her rendition of Edith Ann, and that's the truth.
Years old. That's this many, and then some more. Yesterday, I made a sandwich, and I'm going to tell you about it. First, I took two slices of bread, and I put peanut butter on one slice, and then I put mustard on the other. And then I took out some salami and some cheese and pickles and lettuce, and I put it on the mustard side. And then I sprinkled some raisins from a little red box onto the peanut butter side. And some fell off, but most stayed on. And then I got some tuna fish and black olives. And I put it on the cheese. And then I got the oatmeal that I didn't finish eating for breakfast. And I put that on top too. And then I put the two pieces together and I swooshed them under a big, heavy book called The Dictionary. And I swooshed it on the floor, and some fell out, but most stayed in. And then I called my dog Buster over, and I'm like, Buster, come over and taste it. So Buster came, and he circled around and around, and sniffing. And then he looked up at me. And then he circled again, and he just looked scared. And he wouldn't taste it. And I said, Buster, taste it. But he wouldn't. So I did. And I took a taste, and he was right. It was terrible. So I put it all back where it came from. But there was some oatmeal on the cheese. And I got most of the raisins back, but some of them fell on the floor, and some of them had peanut butter. And I ate the pickles. And Mama came in and she saw the mess and she was pretty angry. And she told me that I couldn't make any more sandwiches again until I was 6. But that's okay, because Buster and I, we're going to use the telephone and we're going to call out for pizza. Because we like pizza with extra cheese and pepperoni. Yeah, we both like it a lot. I love my dog Buster. He's my best friend. I like to kiss him on the lips. But sometimes I put mouthwash in this doggy water dish because, you know, kissing a dog on the lips isn't very pleasant. But I like to dress my Buster up and try different household products on him. One day he was in the bathtub and the bottle of bleach kind of accidentally fell in the water. And all his fur fell out. But that's okay, because now I can write on him with a magic marker. Yeah, I don't get sick very much because I have leprosy. My friend Buck Phillips Jr., he went to Vietnam. He's 6. But I like red jelly beans. I love red jelly beans, because you know what you could do? You could just lick them just a little bit, and you could smear them on your lips, and it looks just like lipstick, except lipstick costs $1, and you can't eat it after. Yeah. But I don't have to talk if I don't want to. I can have a baby if I want me to, actually. I can tell you how to have a baby. See? First, you get a big fat belly, and then you can eat all the pickles you want. And then Daddy gets all the clothes and throws them in the car, and then he gets really nervous. And then the policeman comes, and he gives him a ticket. And he takes the ticket to the hospital, and he got a baby boy. That's how you have a baby. We have a baby brother at my house, Russell. We don't like him very much. We're trying to get rid of him. Mama told me Russell had a soft spot on his head and we shouldn't touch it. So I took a ballpoint pen and I made an X on it so I would remember. Yeah. You never know. And that's the truth.
Of pine for dreams, wrap me tight in earthen clothes. fine morning when this life is over,
I'll fly away
to a home on God's celestial shore.
Thank you.
now for something completely different. We go right from Mr. Sandman to the Nutcracker Suite. If you have never had the opportunity to see the Nutcracker in its entirety, I finally saw it this past December, and it was danced actually by my daughter Kelly's dance troupe out of Laconia, New Hampshire. And it was just a pleasure to see not only, you know, I love watching my daughter dance, but to see the show for the first time all the way through from start to finish. We all know the dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies. And we hear the songs every year. Right now, two very, very talented young ladies who also brought the Nutcracker to life for us this past December. And I hear it's going to become a yearly tradition with their dance company. And I will look forward to that performance next year. But right now, we're going to have Miss Greta Jennison and Miss Samantha Urbina doing the dance of the Harlequin and Columbine Dolls from the Nutcracker. Songs of the Season concert back in December, I had the opportunity to sing the Hawaiian Christmas song Mele Kalikimaka with several members of this troupe that's going to perform for us next and our last act of the evening. And we're waiting for that thumb, that elusive thumb. How are we doing? Darla, you have one more joke. Ladies and gentlemen, Darla.
So one more joke. So we're here at the 10 Below Variety Show, and I have a joke about a snowman. It's short, so get ready with the thumb. So what do you get when you cross a snowman and a vampire? Frostbite. And a million of them.
I'm going home with her later. I'm a lucky, lucky boy. Ladies and gentlemen. Oh, I hear something back there. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, our last act really needs no introduction. They've been around town for several years. Lots of fun. Whole lots of great music coming your way. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage the Vermont Ukulele Society. are part of the eternal quest to answer some of humanity's basic questions, the first of which is coffee or tea?
Test.
all. And we have a great website, vtyouth.com. Check us out. All sorts of good things there. We're going to finish up with a song written by not one, but two queens. We're going to do a mashup of Happy Trails and Aloha Away. Happy Trails, written by the queen of country music, Gail Evans. And Aloha Away, written by Queen Liliuokalani of Hawaii. Give yourselves a great big round of applause.